Welcome to Math 20S. It's grade 10, week 2. And this week we're doing basic algebra, integers, fractions. That's the review stuff from prior grades. And the main stuff we're learning is our linear model still. So we'll be hastening things in week 3. Next slide. All right. Here's another one in this intercept form where you're going to plot where the x is 0 and the y is 0. Right, so the x and y's are on the same side. Some sites call this the general form. That's kind of confusing. Or this, some people call this different things. I call it the intercept form. All right, so there's how you would do that. Next slide. Oh, the trick on this one, of course, when you tried to graph it on your graph paper, you didn't have enough room. Because you can't put 0, 15 on your graph paper. Well, you could, because most of you are counting by ones. Well, if you find you can't squeeze something on your graph paper because there's not enough lines, who says you got to count by ones? You're allowed to count by nickels, right? You can count by nickels. Nobody said you got to make each line worth one. Just count by nickels or tens or whatever different scale it takes to make things fit on there. Right? Nobody said you actually had to count by ones. You can count by nickels or dimes or whatever. Next slide. All right, so here's day 3, week 2. Warm up mental math. So you can just pause it right there if you want. Okay, there's what the mental math questions were. And do these without paper. And don't even use a calculator. You should be able to do these in your head. What's up with Bravo there? And then convert these to decimal. So just do these in your head. B's all right.
My brain hurts!
Okay, so you can pause her there if you want. Next slide. All right, and multiplying by 10 is pretty easy. You just wing an extra zero on the end. If you just, or think of it as a decimal, 7.0, multiplying by 10 moves the decimal 0.1. How about multiplying by 15? Well, multiplying by 15 is pretty easy. The easy way to do it in your head is to think of 15 as a dime and a nickel. And you know that 70 times 10 is 700. Well, then 70 times 5 is going to be half of that. So what's half of 700? 350. So you got to sort of remember a couple numbers in your head on the left side and the right side. 700, 350. Add them together. 1,050. You got to practice these, of course. You can do these on a bit of paper and practice them. And after a while, you'll have them down in your head pretty good. And, of course, 15 is kind of important for when you're doing... tips and for waitresses and servers, rather. All right. Now, here's the neat thing I showed you. Not everybody does multiplying this stupid way right here. Right? That's not the way we teach you in grade 5. Is not stupid. It's very efficient, and it works well, and it works reliably, and so it is a good way. But there are other cultures that multiply other ways. Here's the way. I saw this on YouTube once. Here's the way they do it in China, I think. Notionally, I suppose. All right. So what they do is, if they wanted to do 12, they put down like a slurpee straw for the tens, and two slurpee straws there that way for the ones, and then times 33, they put down like three red straws for the tens, and a purple and three purple straws for the ones going that way. Okay. So there's your three tens and your three ones, and they'd see how many places the red straws crossed each other. All right, so they're going to see how many places, three places. And then they see how many places the red straws crossed the purple straws. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And then they'd see how many places all the oneses crossed each other, all the purple straws. 1, 2, 3, 4, 6. So 396. There you go. And this works with even bigger numbers. Sometimes you got carries, but I didn't want to show you that. All right, but it works. It's kind of cool. Show that to your nephew. You might get excited about math. Okay, so there's one way to show multiplying and why it works. We'll figure that out later on. Here's another way that other cultures work. In fact, this is the way that they multiplied for thousands of years before we invented that other way. All right, this is the way the Egyptians do it. And this is actually how computers do it. All right, so the way they do it is, say you want to multiply 33 times 12. All you got to do is know how to double numbers. All right, so you only need to know your two times table, and you have to know how to add. So on the left there, you would write down one, you would always write down 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64. All right, so in the old days, they'd have holes in the ground, and the left hole was worth 1, and the next hole was worth 2, etc., and they'd throw pebbles in. All right, so anyway, so you always write 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32 in a column there. Now you take your 12, and you write it down. All right, here comes your 12, you write it down, and then you're going to double it. So doubling a 12 is 24, double that is 48, double that is 96. So you got to be able to double in your head. Well, doubling is easy. You just add it to itself. All right. So if you want to know what 33 times 12 is, well, you take what's in the ones row and what's in the 32s row, because 32 and 1 is 33. So you're going to take the 12 and you're going to add it to the 384. And gee, seems to me like you're going to get 396. There you go. You add those two together. You try it now. You try it for, I don't know, 33 times something. Let's try 14 times 12. Oh, yeah, let's try 14 times 12. I'm sorry. Well, to make 14, you would take the 2, the 4, and the 8, because 2 plus 4 plus 8 would make 14. So that means you're going to add the 24, the 48, and the 96. This is how computers do it, by the way. All right, so if you add those up, son of a gun, you get 168. And that's the correct answer, by the way. And this is actually how computers do it. I'm not kidding you. Anyway, that's kind of funky. But who cares how they do it? We got our way of doing it. And we got a plastic brain. We get to use that instead. Yep, so if you ever want to mess about at lunch, I'll show you how this stuff works. It's kind of fun. How computers count. It's really fun, especially negative numbers. Next slide. Convert to decimals, right? Maybe you remember how we did that. To divide by 25, all you do is multiply by 4 and divide by 100. That's the secret to dividing by 25 in your head. You could do it the long way, long division. But the answer is 0.28, because, look, it's the same as saying 1 over 25, which is really 4 over 100. Everybody can multiply by 4, you just double, and everybody can divide by 100, you just move the decimal point. There you go. So all you do is multiply by 4, divide by 100, I'll reanimate. So multiply by 4, divide by 100, double, and move the decimal point. Next slide. So what's 11 divided by 25? 0.44. What's 18 divided by 25? 0.72. What's 13 divided by 0.25, rather? 0.52. Multiply by 4, divide by 100. Anyway, just a little mental math trick there. Next slide, reviewing algebra. This is handout review 3. Okay, so if we said x plus 8 is 15, x plus 8 is 15, some number plus 8 is 50. It's sort of like a party game. I'm thinking of a number. If you added 8 to this number, the answer would be 15. All right, so what is the number I'm thinking of? The number I'm thinking of, if you added 8, would be 15. Now, your mission is to get X. Find out what it is. X is blue. So somehow or other, you got to get X all by itself. So here, let's do it without any numbers. All right, Pretend there's a mystery bag with some stuff in it, and I said that if you added 8 pebbles to that bag, you'd have 15 pebbles. You don't need numbers to do math. All right, so the mystery number plus 8 pebbles gives you 15 pebbles. There you go. Now, those 8 pebbles that aren't in the bag have nothing to do with the pebbles in the bag, do they? So you got to subtract them. So you take away the 8 pebbles that aren't in the bag. So that means what's in the bag must be, well, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 pebbles. I just did math without numbers. Well, until I flung that 7 in there, because you guys like numbers. I hate numbers. There's too many of them. Next slide. Yeah, let me just reanimate that real quickly then. There you go. Next slide. Same thing. Oh, so here's how you do it using algebra, because not everybody wants to draw pebbles, and sometimes you lose your pebbles or lose your marbles too. So the way you do it using algebra and numbers is x plus 8 is 15. You don't want that 8 there. You tell your buddy, hey, take away that 8 that you added to my pile of pebbles. I don't want those extra 8. Take them away. Otherwise, you messed up what's in my bag of marbles. So he takes away the 8. So you don't have 15 anymore because he took away 8. So you're back to what you had originally before your buddy threw another 8 marbles in the sand next to your bag of pebbles. So there you go. So your bag of pebbles must have had 7 pebbles in it. It's all got to do with the pebbles. All right, so there's the steps. Whatever was done to your unknown, you undo it. Till you get the unknown by itself. It's impossible to screw up algebra. If you do the same thing to both sides of the equation, you cannot screw up. Let's just animate this. Add 6 to both sides. You can't screw up. Let's animate a couple of these. These are all off your handout. Revision number 3. Somebody took away 2. You're going to re-add 2. So you're going to make sure the left and right side, same thing to both. Adding 2 cancels the takeaway 2. Adding 2 to the 4 makes 6. Does y equal 6? You better check your answer. If y is 6, you just make sure that 6 minus 2 actually is 4, because now y is not unknown, because you figured it out. As long as there's only one unknown, you can always figure it out like this. W plus 7 equals 18. Some number plus 7 is 18. So take away the 7 that somebody flung in the dirt there next to your W marbles. All right, so now you're down to your W marbles is 7 less than 18. So you must have had 11 marbles or pebbles or whatever you're counting. So is 11 plus 7 equal 18? Give yourself a little happy face there. All right, let's just reanimate that one last time to show you that you're just undoing what was done. Yeah, and actually do that happy face for me sometimes, just so I know that you actually checked the answer. Right, so Jeb spent $5. He has $7 left. How much did he start with? Now, this seems kind of trivial, but can you put it into words? All right, so he started with 12. How much did he do? He spent $7, did he? Let's have a look. What does it say here? He spent $5. He has $7 left. How much did he start with? All right, so the secret to doing these, if you want to make equations, I mean, besides this is obvious, is you want, the last sentence tells you what you're looking for, how much he started with. So since you don't know, give it a name, a variable, an unknown. Give it a name like X or T or Z, I don't care, but usually we use X. So how would you turn that into a sentence mathematically? How much did he start with? Well, he started with X, didn't he? And then he subtracted 5. If you spend money, isn't that a debit? Isn't that adding a negative? So he started with X, then he subtracted 5, and he ended up with 7. So how much did he start with? Well, you add back the five, or you go get a refund, I guess. So if you add back the five to undo the five that he spent, it's like going back and getting a refund. He must have started with 12. Next slide. Solve using multiplying and dividing. Sometimes you add and subtract to get rid of a subtract and an add. Guess what? If you've got multiplying, the way to undo a multiply is to divide. And let me just show you how to do that without numbers, because nobody likes numbers. Let's animate this. All right, way too many numbers in math. So let's solve. If you had 3 somethings equals 15. Well, technically this is n3s equals 15. Same thing. All right, so you got something plus, isn't that 3 somethings? That's what we mean by multiplying. I'm gonna do it all in pebbles. No numbers, we're not allowed numbers here. All right, so when you do that, you end up with, let me just back this up a bit, right? When you do that, you can take those three and put them there, and those three and put them there, and those three and put them there. Those five. So five goes into each bag. All right, so five would go into each bag. There you go. And 3 fives, 5 plus 5 plus 5 would be 15. So notice I pretty much did it just by drawing pebbles and you don't really need to use numbers. Let me reanimate that one last time. There's the pebbles. Each bag has 5, so your n must be 5. The unknown is 5. The way to do it with algebra is just to divide both sides by 3. Because you wanted to unmultiply by 3. The way to unmultiply by 3 was to divide both sides by 3. So 15 divided by 3 ends up being that. How do you do a divided by 3, or 1/3 of an a, equals 9? Let's try that. I'm going to try drawing it. Okay? I'm going to draw you a bag of a things. A third of a bag of A things. All right, so there's A things, and I broke it into 3 parts. So whatever's in that bag is broken into 3 parts. So each part would be called a third. Well, if a third is 9, then the other third would have another 9, and the other third would have another 9. So wouldn't you have 27 total? Using the algebra, of course, you're going to undivide by 3. The way to undivide by 3 is to multiply by 3. Because the 3 divided by the 3 is the 1. And then, of course, since you multiplied the left side by 3, you got to multiply the right side by 3. You end up with A is 27. And that's because a third of an A was 9. Let me reanimate that one all over again. Next slide. Skip that. I just wanted to show you that in physics, some simple formulas will be linear equations. Your final velocity is your initial velocity plus your acceleration times your time. So your final speed is your initial speed plus how long you hold down the gas pedal. That's what it says. Don't worry about that crap, but notice it's the same sort of thing. Okay, next slide. Let's animate. Okay. X over 3 equals 4. And notice I like to rewrite the equation again, because I find students, they'll write down the question, they'll have the question written down in their handout, and then they'll start scribbling all over it, and before you know it, you can't keep track of what the original question was. So I always like to rewrite it, and then I diddle with it from there. All right. That way you don't mess up the original equation and lose track of what it is with all kinds of gobbledygook. So I rewrote it, and the way I undo the 3 is to multiply both sides by 3. So to undo the divide by 3, I multiply both sides by 3. So the 3 divided by the 3 leaves 1x on the other side, and then you get 4 times 3 is 12. Check out 4 Bravo here. Divide by 6 on both sides. So 1A must be 54. Yeah. See, I didn't follow my rule there. I messed up the original. I messed around with the original equation in 4B. So you could lose track of what you're really doing. Except that I've got color there, so you don't lose track too much. Let's animate these here. And these speak for themselves. And you got dozens and dozens of these with the answers, for goodness sake, and my website and my YouTube channel. There's 1 hour. All right, good. This should be a fairly few more minutes here. Hockey game's on. Notice what you just want to undo what was done to your ex. Whatever gets done to your ex, you want to undo it to get the X by itself. And it doesn't matter whether the X or the N is on the left or the right. Doesn't matter, because you could walk in behind that paper and look at it, and it would be the right way to you, right? So it doesn't matter whether your unknown is on the left or your right. Whether you say that I is 23 or 23 am I, you're saying the same thing. You're equating two things together. Next slide. All right, here's a two-step one, and we're not dancing here. All right, now we got some addings and some multiplyings going on. So on this one here, you've got 4n's plus 5 is 17. So you had n things. Somebody went and quadrupled them, and then threw an extra 5 loose things on top of them and said, there you go, you got 17 things. Now your question is, how many things were n to start with before somebody quadrupled your n and then added 5? Right, so yeah, same sort of steps. You just got to do 2 different steps. Next slide, let's animate it. So it's a 2-step problem. Now I'm going to, as usual, because this is the way you would explain it to your nephew, which, by the way, is a good way to learn how to do stuff, is explain it to somebody else. How do you think teachers know it so well? All right, so here's 4n's. So 4n's, so 4 bags with n in them. Well, that fourth one should have an n. 4 bags with n things plus 5 loose marbles equals, notice I'm not using any numbers, all right? I'm not using any number. I'm just using marbles. I haven't lost my marbles yet. All right, now, those 5 marbles on the left aren't in bags, so clearly you got to take away the 5 marbles. So if you got to take away 5 marbles, you got to take them away from the other side. Now you got 4 bags, and you got to share the remaining pebbles with the 4 bags. Well, 3 could go there, 3 there, 3 there, 3 there. Hey, each bag would have 3 pebbles, because 3 plus 3 plus 3 plus 3 plus 5. Well, 4 threes plus 5 would be 17. Absolutely amazing. So don't forget to give yourself a little happy face there. Now, of course, you would probably do this with math and algebra, right? You wouldn't actually draw pebbles. So the first thing to do is un-add the 5. So you subtract 5 from both sides. All right, so that's going to leave you with 4n on the left. So you're closer to getting the n by itself. So now you got quadruple n. So how do you unquadruple something? Well, you just break it into 4 piles, divided by 4. So it turns out that 1n must equal 3, which is what the pebbles were trying to tell you. N equals 3. Next slide. Let's just animate this. So I think we actually, yeah, we did a whack of this last week too. And I've got a 3/4-inch thick booklet of this crap. And yeah, this is pretty good math. All right, you should have been doing this before you came to this course for sure. Next slide, enemy. Add 10, multiply by 12, 144. Check your answer. is 144 divided by 12. Let's see, that'd be 12. And then 12 take away 10. 12 subtract 10 would be, yeah, it's 2. Yeah, I like it. Beautiful. So there's the old happy face again. Right on. Okay, next slide. Well, we already did that one. Next slide. All right, and then that was the end of the day, so I thought we'd have some fun, grade 12. So this is where Uncle Leo asks you to come visit him, and he's going to pay you to work at the farm. So he gives you two plans there. You can, now everybody's done this one by now, he gives you plan A. He'll pay you $10 per day. Wouldn't that be nice? 10 bucks a day, 21 days, that's a few dollars. Or he'll give you plan B. All right, he'll start you with a penny right there. And then the next day he'll double it to 2 cents. So that's your pay for the second day. And then on the third day, how much pay is he going to give you for day three? You know, for the entire day. For one day he'll give you 4 cents. And then on the fourth day, he's going to double what he paid you yesterday. So he's going to give you 8 cents for the day's pay on there. And of course you're banking it all, right? You're working on a farm, you got no place to spend it. So by the end of day four, heck, you got 1 and 2 makes 3 and 4 makes, you got 15 cents after the first 4 days working for Uncle Leo, if you take that plan. So which plan would you take? Well, I think most of you knew that there was going to be a trick to this, so you took the intuitively wrong one, and it was a good thing. So obviously it turns out if you work for 21 days, it's 10 plus 10 plus 10 plus 10. So it's total of 10, 20, 30, 40. It's called multiplying. You're going to end up with 21 days, 10 bucks each, $210 right there. All right, 210 bucks for 3 weeks work. Yeah, it's a nice farm, what the heck. Okay, now what happens if you do plan B? All right, so notice the penny for day one. Then you save it. Then you get 2 cents, gives you a total of 3. Then you get 4 cents for the next day, gives you a total of 7. Then you get 8 cents for the fourth day, gives you a total of the 7 plus the 8 makes 15. And then, well, you know what? Look at this. If you kept going, as most of you discovered when you filled in the table, after 21 days, your last day of pay just for the day is $10,000. And by adding all the previous days to that, you end up with $20,971.51. So I think plan D is probably better. And believe it or not, as I showed you on this fun exercise, there is a formula. You could have just found out those last two numbers directly without having to calculate all the other days. It turns out that, well, here, let me animate this a little bit. It turns out if you wanted to know what the last day's of pay was, and this was just to get you to practice using your calculator. You don't really have to understand this yet, because guess what? It's really grade 12. So all you got to do is have a glimpse, a glimmer of what we're doing here. But here's a secret formula you use. All right, put this in your calculator. All right, the pay for day N. So if you want to know how much pay you're getting for any particular day, whether it be day 5 or 6 or 21, you take 0.01 and then hit your multiply button and then hit 2 and then that exponent button, the y to the x, and then 20. And it will tell you how much your pay is. All right. Now you use 20 because you take away 1 from the number of days you work. All right. So when you do that on your calculator, it tells you the exact same number you came up with, except way quicker. You didn't have to calculate the 20 days ahead of it. So there's how much pay you're getting on the 20th day. What is the total pay? Well, there's another formula for that, too. Now, this is all grade 12, so don't take a hairy on me here. All right, so here's the formula. S stands for sum. So if you want to know the sum of all the pay that you got, well, there's your penny showing there. And there was 21 days, so you go 2 raised to the 21, subtract 1 in brackets. So type this into your calculator, bada bing, bada boom. And when you hit enter, it'll tell you the total is $20,971. That's exactly what you calculated, except it got there way quicker and it got there directly. So this is grade 12 stuff, all right? So don't get excited about that. You got another 4 months to do this stuff. But it's called exponential. Notice it's not a line. It's something that grows, like blasts off like a rocket ship. And that's actually how interest and bank accounts and mold and some diseases and population, anything that's, yeah, Anything that reproduces does. Our Earth's population is doing that too. But that's grade 12, so don't get too excited. But it is kind of fun to see that you can calculate stuff like that with your calculator. Next slide. Oh, and then somebody said, well, what if you stayed for 30 days? Well, guess what? If you stayed on Plan B for 30 days, check it out. Use the formula. Right? Don't fill in the table. You could do it, but it would be a waste of time. It turns out your sum, the sum of your pay after 30 days, if you plug into this formula and you know how to use your calculator with these exponents, that's the Y to the X button, right? If you plug in that formula, and there's how you do exponents, is with this Y to the X button, your uncle would owe you $5,368,709.11, and that's exact to the penny. Kind of fun, eh? And then we got a little carried away here, and then I told you there was an old fable about some Egyptian fellow or something that saved the Pharaoh from some pestilence or something, and the Pharaoh said, oh, what can I do for you? And I guess checkers were in vogue in Egypt too. He says, give me one grain of wheat on one corner of a checkerboard, and then give me two grains of wheat on the next corner, and then four on the next one, and then eight, and then 16, and just keep doubling it on every square of a checkerboard. All right. So it turns out the Pharaoh said, oh, that's easy. That's not going to be too much wheat. Well, here's how much wheat the Pharaoh had to give the guy for ridding the Pharaohdom of whatever he ridded him of. All right. Here's the formula. Now, bearing in mind, this is grade 12 stuff, folks. We got carried away here. So it turns out the sum of all the grains of wheat is going to be 1 times 2 raised to the 63 exponent. So that's that 2. Y to the X, 63. All right? It turns out that it's such a big number, your calculator can't list it. So it kicks into that exponential notation. So it says 9.22 e to the 18th for some of you. Or some of you that might say 9.22 times 10 to the 18th. So it means 9.22 multiplied by 10 18 times. So it means 9.22, and you move the decimal 18 places. So here it comes. So there's how much wheat the Pharaoh had to give the guy. That's what you call a RBFN, a really big number. Because how big is that? That's like... what is that? That's there's your thousands, millions, billions, trillions, quadrillions? Quintillion. 9,220,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000, All right, week two, day four, we're doing mental math. Mental math, do this without paper, without pencil, without, well, I was going to say without a brain, but that'd be hard. All right, so do those, pause the video if you want. And some of these we learned, next slide. Okay, so 18 times 15, remember the little trick to doing that? The little trick to 18 times 15 is to think of it as 18 dimes and 18 nickels. And 18 dimes is 180, and nickels are going to be half as much as the 180. So if you can think of a number and then add half of it, pretty easy. What's 18 times 12, for example? That wasn't one on there, but I mean, if you can think of 18 tens and 18 twos, if you break the 12 into tens and twos, multiplying by tens is easy, that's 180, and multiplying 18 by 2 is 36. Hopefully you can do that in your head. So if you can remember two numbers in your head at the same time, that sort of helps, but it does help to practice. Next slide. 14 times 25, right? Same sort of thing. You could turn the 25 into 20-cent pieces and nickels, but we don't have 20-cent pieces. So you could do it that way, right? You could, C-U-D, right? Or another way you could do it is, the way I prefer to do it, is you can think of 25 as, well, here's the way you could have done it. Or you can think of 25 as being 100 over 4. Because most people can multiply by 100. You can just wing two zeros on the end. And a lot of times it's easy to divide by 4 because you divide by 2 twice. So 1,400 divided by 4. Well, 1,400 divided by 2 would be 700. So 1,400 divided by 4 would be 350. So you just half and half. Now, something like 1,437 divided by 4, you wouldn't be able to do exactly in your head. You could get close, but right? But a lot of times it comes out to a nice even number that's easily divisible by 2 twice. In other words, divisible by 4. All right. So there's what I suggest you might be able to do. Animate that again. Not that way. This way. Turn 25 into 100 divided by 4. Just like when we are dividing by 25, we turned it into 4 divided by 100. Kind of neat, eh? Okay, next slide. 7 divided by 25. Remember, I taught you this trick. This trick was to divide by 25, you multiply by 4, and divide by 100. So I think this is about the third day we showed this. So let's just race through this. To divide by 25, multiply by 4, and divide by 100. Because 1 over 25 is the same as 4 over 100. So it's obviously 28 with the decimal point, 0.28. Next slide. And let's do these, animate real quickly here. So 11 divided by 25 has to be 0.44. Oh, okay, do it that way. And, yeah. It's 0.44. Come on, it's 0.44. There you go. And always put a leading zero in front of a decimal if there's no digit there. All right. Same thing here. Let's animate to multiply by 25, multiply by 100, and then half and half. So half and half. Half and half. Half of half is a quarter. Now, here's my favorite right here. I'm going to quickly do this. And so I gave you 25 squared, 35 squared, and 75 squared. And I said, do those in your head. Well, of course, you don't know the trick yet, do you? Well, you could have done them in your head. Well, yeah, you'd have to do them the way you do them on paper in your head, which isn't right. There's got to be a better way to do it. The way you do it on paper is good, but it's not the type of thing you do in your head. So there's a trick here, and I think some of you started to see the pattern. But seeing as how we've known this for 3,000 years, I didn't make you figure it out totally yourself. But most people did notice that when you raise something to the exponent of 2, and I told you the answers here, 625, 1225, and obviously 75 squared is going to be 5,625. There it is. Now some people started to notice some of the pattern. Turns out they all end in 25. Woohoo! Well, you're getting closer to the answer. And what is the pattern, though? What is 45 squared? Well, 45 times 45 is going to be 2025, obviously. How did I get that? Well, let's just do them all here. 55 squared is going to be 3025. 65 squared is going to be 4225. 85 squared is going to be 7225. Yeah, 95 squared will be 9025, obviously. How do you do that? Well, you know they all end in 25, all right? Yeah, and you don't have to know how to do this. If you want to use a plastic brain, go for it. But you'll be a party animal if you do this. So how do you get these other digits, though, in front? You know they all end in 25. Well, check out 2 here. What's the number that comes after 2 when you're counting? 3. 2 times 3 is 6. Hey, neat, eh? How about 3? What's the number that comes after 3 when you're counting? 4. 3 times 4 is 12. Amazing. How about 5? What's the number that comes after 5 when you're counting? How about 6? So 5 times 6 is 30. Yeah, let's skip a few. How about 8? What's the number that comes after 8 when you're counting? 9. 8 times 9 is 72. So there you go. So now you know that 65 squared ends in 25, and since 6 times 7 is 42, that's a 42, 25, 4,220. It's just a neat trick, right? So now you're a party animal. Okay, then we introduced you to the TI-83 graphing calculator. So the TI-83, chances are somebody in your family has one that's collecting dust somewhere. If you've been in high school in the last 15 years and you've never seen one of these, you should be complaining to your school, because every school in the universe uses these, all right? Next slide, for the last 15 or 20 years. So TI-83 graphing calculator. So we looked at the graphing calculator. It's what you call in the old days WYSIWYG. What you see is what you get. You pretty well type in exactly what you rate normally. All right. So if you type in an expression or an equation, it's pretty much typed in exactly as you would write it. It's WYSIWYG. What you see is what you get. Oh, there's a W in there, a Y. What you see is what you get. Okay, so... and then we don't have an equals button on it, we have an enter button. All right, so we did some practice there, 5 times 8. I showed you the square button and all that stuff. I even showed you that you can type in brackets, and you don't even need the time symbol, for goodness sake. All right, it knows if you got a number in front of brackets that it must be timesing it. And don't forget the enter is equals, so yeah, it understands brackets, it understands the way you write. It's got a plus minus button on it, except it's not a plus minus, it's actually a little white negative button, like that, down by the enter button. So it's slightly different, and the beauty of the TI-83 is you actually put the negative in front of the number, unlike the Dollarama calculators where you got to put in the number, then toggle it to make that number negative. All right, so it's beautiful, and everything you type in is still listed there. You can see exactly what you wrote down in your expression. It's written in the same order you write it on paper. It's not all messed up. All right, it also reduces fractions. It converts to decimals. It does lowest common multiples. It does greatest common factors. It's just a computer, right? All these things are easy to do. They just take work. Well, guess what? Computers are really good at doing stupid things quickly. All right? So, computers are really good at doing easy things real quick. All right? So, there you go. It will actually take 72 104ths and, you know, boom, turn it into 9 13ths for you. So, you don't even have to think. Well, you got to know how to use the machine. All right? So, let's see how to plot points using it. So, you know, if you didn't know how to plot 2, 4, it'll do it. All right, so there's the notes that I gave you, and I'll put them on your reference notes, too. All right, your reference notes should have that stuff, too. I've neglected to put it on your cheat sheet. So there's the stuff we were doing. Next slide. All right, so we also looked at an example that I did on the board here. Let's pretend that we're going to graph, let's plot people's income versus the number of years of school they have. All right. Because I think most people realize that the longer you spend in school, the better your annual income is, all right? And it's not exactly a line, you know. There are people that, you know, have few years in school but make lots of money. You know, maybe they're very good tradesmen or drug dealers or something. And there are people that have lots of years in school and don't have any income hardly, because guess what? It's just not important to them, you know. Some people are happy to have PhDs and live out in the bush, and, you know, with a guitar and a good dog. What else do you need? All right, so not everything's going to be exactly on a line, but there will often be a trend. Some sort of a line might be a trend there, something like this. And we learned how to do that on the graphing calculator. Okay, so your years of school versus your income is not an exact for everybody, but it does have a trend like that. The longer you spend in school, the better your annual income is going to be. All right, and what else did we were still just introducing you to the TI-83. You can even graph things with it. See there how I'm graphing things there on that side, and you can do the table on this side. And of course, once you can do the table, you can actually do algebra. You can actually solve algebra. So if I said 2x minus 4 equals 6, well, I type it in, it draws the graph for you there, and you can see that when x is 5, the y is 6. So that says, what would you have to put in for an x so that 2x minus 4 would equal 6? And you say, well, there's the 6, so the x must be 5. There you go. So an x of 5 would give you a 6. It actually does algebra for you. Ha, ha, ha. It actually guesses all the possible answers, and then the one that gives you the answer you want is what you call the solution. Anyway, this is all just introduction to the machine. It's a pretty neat machine, okay? If you're going to be in applied math, you'll be so used to this thing, you'll be a Texas Instrument king or queen. All right, so then I gave some of you Alpha 6. The morning class didn't get Alpha 6. They got Alpha 7, but Alpha 6 they'd had as well. And I said, let's do these, and let's also do them on the calculator. So Alpha 6 looks like this, two slides to go. Graph the equation y equals negative 1 half x minus 2. So, of course, you're going to do a table. And, of course, you better choose x of 0 straight away, because multiplying by 0 is pretty good. So negative 1 half of 0, then take away 2 is obviously, well, whatever that constant number is at the end, the negative 2 is the answer. And then you tried 5. Notice we're picking numbers like 5 and 10 and negative 5, because then the 5 and the denominator will cancel them out, and you can do them in your head. Right, 10's pretty good too. If you want to use 4, go for it, but then you'll end up with something weird like negative 2 and 4 fifths. Right? Why would you do that? Pick a number that you cancel out the denominator. Here's where you graph it. Alright, graph it like that. Bada bing, bada boom. Here come your points, 3 points. So, do assignment 6 manually. You have the answers as well. And check them with a graphing calculator too, just to make sure you didn't do a boo-boo. And here's the last one. This is the last one. Y equals negative 5x minus 1. This is on alpha 6. Alright, so do this, do the table. Obviously, you're going to use x of 0, because everybody can multiply by 0 pretty well. Then you're going to plug in a couple other ones that fit on your graph paper. And then when you go to graph them, bada bing, bada boom, they look like that, those points. That should make a straight line, otherwise the universe is about to collapse. And put them on the graphing calculator too, right? Because if you do applied math, you're going to probably always use the calculator for this stuff anyways, right? I'm going to try not to get you too hooked on it, but it is a beautiful machine. So I think that's about it. Goodness. Hour 26. Wow. I'm going to go watch the hockey game. That concludes this briefing.